Does any group have what they consider to be an important question that they would like to share now for everybody to consider?
We were sort of very open as well.
Just to stop you quiet, because we were going to, would somebody from the group like to come and join our speakers to share the question?
We were very struck by the idea that obviously the last speaker was talking about the framework of neoliberalism and that, you know, we were talking about that the indicators we're judged on internationally and nationally are not what we would choose and how do we begin to influence the politicians. And I was in a workshop last week in a conference about teachers as agents of change, and I shared something with the group which seemed to resonate about how can teachers see themselves as agents of change, not objects of change? Because we agreed we have education systems where things are done to teachers, and teachers just respond. So they don't actually see that things could be different, that the neoliberal construct is just a construct, that actually there are other ways of doing things, there are other ways of measuring achievement, there are other ways of actually forming curricula. There are other ways of engaging young people as citizens. But unless you see yourself as an agent of change and are encouraged in that, then the system won't change.
So how can they see themselves as agents of change rather than as objects of change? Just to simplify. So I'm going to first, just to be able to manage things, to ask if any of our speakers would like to respond to that question.
Can I say something on this? Because I think this is, we often position the nexus of change, the place where the change is happening, in one place or another. So we say, how can we get young people to become agents of change, teachers to be agents of change? But actually, change is happening all around us. And the question doesn't have to be who is the agent of change. It's also who are the participants in change, because change is either going to happen to our students or our students are going to participate in change. And if you look at the amount of global change we've been talking about, it's everyone. And we sometimes create active-passive dialectic. Who's active, who's passive? And actually, whether you like it or not, if you're not active, you are passive because of the amount of global change. So I think it's quite useful to conceive our students to be both participants in change that affects them, and if they want, to be agents of change, as protagonists in change. But nobody escapes the change process because it's happening so quickly to us all, isn't it? So I think that it's quite useful not to allow the discussion to be an either or, but all is changing, and all is changing fast, and all is changing too fast for most of us. We can't keep up with it. People, because the change is happening so quickly, we are looking for archetypes, we're looking for stereotypes to manage the change. So we're reverting to racial stereotypes, we're reverting to all kinds of tribalisms in order to protect ourselves from change. But we have to participate in it and educate our students and therefore our teachers to be ready to be in on the amount of changes happening in the world.
Okay. I'd like to provide the opportunity for one more speaker to respond if they would like to, before asking if anyone else would like to say
anything. Can we actually repeat Martin's question? Martin's final question. What kind of change are we talking about? When we're talking about changes happening so rapidly that we can't not change, and then again we ourselves wanting to be agents of change, and apparently we're talking about flows of change with which we agree and flows of change with which we do not. And apparently when we want to be agents, we want to be on that flow, you know, and when it's about being subjects or actually objects of change, it's about the other flow. So I think I'm just asking myself, is change the word we're looking for?
And well, do we see the changes as changes? I mean, do we recognize the changing reality? Or do teachers recognize the changing reality?
Okay, so there's a lot changing changes. Okay, so would anybody else like to contribute any thoughts or responses?
So actually, we also talk about change, and we pose the question, do we really want the change? If so, why and how? It's really related to this question that has just been posed. The reason is we looked at, historically, we looked at where we are today, that a lot of global education is really centered on the presence of inequality. Right? We feel that there are inequalities, whether they wealth or other opportunities, between people who live here, people who live elsewhere, different countries of the world. But these inequalities have roots, some of which are historic. And generally speaking, the situation is such that an average citizen, let's say, of the Czech Republic, feels relatively comfortable compared to the other, at least the other person they can perceive to be the other front of Kinofasok. Why would this person want a change? The educational system as it is has contributed historically also to the situation in which an average European lives. The current system, whether it be political, whether it be, does contribute to this. Now, these changes might actually contribute to a change in the system, in the way people today live, in their economic or social status. Would they really want that? And if they do, how do they change? The question was posed about the mining community. How do you go to them and talk about changes, in the way they live? So this question can actually be put more broadly. How do you talk to a European about change? Will that might affect their circumstances?
I'm wondering, asking at the same time, that you said, Andy, we need to educate teachers and students. But do you also think that we need to educate parents as well? Since education starts from, in very early ages, and parents are having really big impact on people and youngsters and students. And I really wonder to hear what you're thinking.
I tell you, my experience as a parent in a pretty normal area in the UK is of dropping my children off at school. And I, as a parent, I'm thinking, I really hope you learn. And maybe half of the other parents are thinking, I really hope you survive. Because they hate in school. And they think, I'm sorry to do this to you, son, but you're going to have to go through this too. And so I think that often we are asked in our experience in the Citizenship Foundation, surely we should start with the parents. I generally think it's probably too late to start with the parents. Because what can we affect? What can we control? And who can we arouse, get there to think afresh? And so I think to some extent, a good values-based education will ask people to reflect on the values they inherited. So that when you're in school, you don't have to get personal about this. You can say, what are the perspectives we've heard about this? And you don't say, what does your mum and dad think? You just ask, what have we heard? And you get them up there on a sheet, and you find there's lots of perspectives. And then you get people to think about the perspectives. So I would say, genuinely, it's probably too late to wait for parents to change. Can I say one thing to that question? I'm going to close the show. But I think it's an interesting thing that There's a good sort of global value survey which looks at, it's characterized people in three different categories. I don't know if you've come across it. Pioneers, prospectors, and settlers. And settlers are people who don't want anything to change, they just want to stay with it. And pioneers are people who can imagine a different kind of future and want to bring it about. You will all be pioneers, I can assure you. We'll begin with pioneers. The prospectors are people who can imagine doing better in the future. So they want change for personal gain, usually financial or security. Pioneers are visionaries, and therefore they want change because they can see a different value system happening in the world. And settlers are the ones. So there are some people, there is no simple formula, I think. There are some people who want change, some people don't. But the settlers tend to be people who can't imagine things getting better. And the last thing that they want is to get things to get worse. So if you are going to forecast some kind of change for their life through your activism, you want to make sure that it's one that they feel will be secure for them, that won't undermine their current security. And that's another thing in itself, but you have to recognize, I think, some, as you say, some people in some communities don't like the idea of change. They might like a specific change, if you talk about a specific change, but change generically is a scary thing.
Thank you, because I wanted to ensure some kind of response to your contribution. Okay,
yeah,
I want to
maybe forget. I really liked your question. I can't see your name, unfortunately. Mercer. So thank you for the question. What came on my mind is one friend once told me, I learned so much from my children. So I was thinking, why actually parents couldn't learn from their children who are going to school? And then the second point was that I believe the school should be a place where the community is also built and where the parents are involved. And I think that if we work a little bit more on this, we get the learning too.
So does anybody else have another question to share or air out in the open?
Thank you very much. The question that we had in the group reflects a lot on your presentations. It's about how to make global education, whichever notion of global education you want to focus on, personal, so that you can attract teachers and convince them that it's important to take an active role in and escape the comfort zone of following the system. And on a, it's a bit of a multi-layer question. This also, we would like to see how we can apply this to stakeholders as well. You spoke about businesses. And we had a lot of difficulty in the organization that we work with communicating with companies and convincing them to attend some meetings about sustainability and fair trade and unethical production in supply chains, and we have zero response. So this personal element that we asked in global education, we were wondering if your expertise has ever showed you any ways to share with us.
I believe the core really is at the current management and economics education. And I remember one really great program that impressed me at the University of St. Gallen. There is so-called SIM program. It's a very posh, it's number one in Financial Times ranking business schools for 5 years. And they have one great thing. They call it Simagination Challenge. And many students who go there, they really want to be the future CEO, right? To get the big money, etc. What happens to them in this program is that they are asked to manage a project that makes a positive difference. To get in touch with an organization in global South countries, with a social business, and to set a dialogue with them, and start, manage, and finish the project that would help to the organization, including the fundraising. So they have to manage everything. And I saw these students in Switzerland walking in the streets, baking the brownies and the pies, and addressing the people in St. Gallen Street, introducing the project, what they are doing, actually collecting the money from local citizens who support an NGO or a social business there. And I also had a chance to see the reflections of these students, how it totally shaped their view of the world and of the global issues. And I believe if you have more of this in business education, you can meet, hopefully, also future CEOs who will be more open to come to you and address these topics. So check out this imagination challenge.
Sorry,
how do
you spell that?
Yeah, I can write it.
Okay, maybe we'll continue. And I'll just maybe to participants to either ask for that question. So the first about how do we make this attractive, more attractive for teachers, and then the other, I don't know, about wider organisations, businesses. Anybody else?
I would like to start from saying that for me the word changes is scary. Agents of change is even more scary. And I think, but I understand the intentions behind these questions, and I maybe would like to transform this question into how to give meaning to the surrounding world, how to convince people that it is worth thinking, it is worth reflecting on what is going on around them, rather than, you know, adjusting to the space of changes that are really overwhelming for a great majority of people, including myself.
Any other responses to this question or the last speaker? Okay, I think we might just have time for one more question if anybody does want to share a question very much now. Okay.
Educational approach to integrate different perspectives, values, values, professions, and the main idea is by using interdisciplinary education. How do we ensure that it comes to line?
Questions? Why do you want leaders? Oh, how?
How? How? Are we sure? Yes. Ideas, interdisciplinary education, then the education of the social personality, the different roles, age, professions, and so on. But how do you ensure it comes to life, really?
Is it the first thing that comes to my mind, and that's returning to this issue of community? Is that we need a community for that. I mean, any kind of knowledge or certain vision about, well, integrity of different perspectives, different angles, that's a collective undertaking, so to speak. Yeah. So I think we need a kind of a community or networking of people who, well, perhaps spaces like here, so, and only when we really exchange, sometimes confront, we can develop something that's you're asking about. So community.
I just say we had that thought, we developed a program in the UK, which I brought some leaflets for, called Go Givers, which is for primary school age 5 to 11. And it's, it was free because the government paid for it, we now charge for it, but it's 150 different lesson plans and activities. But it's based around trying to develop, well, children are at that age, the kind of predispositions to thinking for them, which gives them a global perspective and a sort of receptivity and openness to diversity and all those kind of things. So rather than talk about it, I've got some leaflets and you can have a look because it was our attempt to do that. But we had to package it, so it's based around 8 cartoon characters, and it's a different methodology for the lower age group and the upper age group. But it's our best attempt to do what you're saying. But it's very hard, I think, making that happen in a school. We had, when it was free, we had 53,000 registered teachers to use it in the UK, half of the primary schools. We now sell it, and there's a lot less people because our government stopped funding it because of our government. But it does need a driver, it needs somebody to be able to push through an innovation, but then it needs a head teacher normally, who says, let's push this into the school. So we spend all our time trying to capture the attention of head teachers.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Nader, did I say
it? Yeah. It's basically very much, it means people behind it when you're asking how to bring it to life. I think we have enough programs around, you know, around the world that would claim to be inclusive and holistic and all those things. So your final question, how do you bring it to life? I think there are two questions. How do you introduce them and how do you sustain them? Know that it's not only a question of now we have a course here or we have a program, but how do you sustain it? Personal engagement, as we say, needs people behind it.
I say now people are buying it. It's a smaller number, but they're doing it. Whereas when it was free, they wouldn't do it. Once they paid for it, so it's very interesting.
Okay, before we finish, would anybody else like to respond to that question or to share any idea or get or something from your experience that in some way responds to that question?
Just a small reflection. For me to sustain holistic program of education, it is a question of bringing in stories of participants. It's not about teaching theories, but it is taking some ideas from life as it is, because all our lives are holistic. It's not like teaching some other stories from other people. That might be inspiring, but primary to use people as library actually of stories that is alive. And then if we want to play, we can go from the personal stories to a little bit more theoretical aspects, as I call it, inductive teaching. But first of all, it is for holistic education, it is stories.
Okay, thank you very much. That really very nicely, I think, brings us.